Rodney Crowell began the late 1970s as a respected songwriter and a single father pursuing a singing career. In 1978, he landed a recording contract with Warner Brothers Records, but after three failed albums, he was dropped in 1984. Yet his success as a songwriter continued, with other artists taking his songs to the top of the charts. When Rodney produced his wife Roseanne Cash's breakthrough album, 7 Year Ache, he found himself in the background again. As Roseanne's fame grew, Rodney's feelings of jealousy grew right along with it.
At the time that Roseanne's career was like exploding, you know, after 7 Year Ache hit, then she started having hit after hit after hit.
It was really hard for Rodney, and he did feel competitive with me, and I guess even sometimes he felt jealous. It was interesting because I didn't put very much stock in fame or recognition.
I was jealous, and it's like she was doing better than me, and it's like, doesn't anybody recognize that I'm smart and I'm talented and I'm contributing to this too, you know? And I pouted about it. I did what any young, insecure man would do, you know, tried to make life hard for her.
He made it hard in a way that two people who are really intimate can, you know, really get on each other's sore spots.
Both Rodney and Roseanne were known for writing about their lives. Whatever was going on in their personal lives eventually made it into their songs, including their problems with one another.
From knowing them both and from seeing what went on between them, it was obvious to me what the source of a lot of lyric content was.
Tell me, don't eat.
I was going through one of those periods where I was cold and distant and, you know, in a funk and not there, you know. And so she starts writing this song, I Don't Know Why You Don't Want Me, and then I get involved in helping her write it. And here we are writing a song about how cold and distant I am, you know.
And then we finished it together. Turned out to be a pretty good song. The next year it won a Grammy.
Their open, honest relationship seemed to increase Rodney and Roseanne's status as the cool, hip couple of country music. Their lifestyle became fast and trendy. When the 1980s saw cocaine become the drug of choice for the elite of Nashville's music industry, Rodney and Roseanne succumbed to the drug's promise of glamour and sophistication. Unfortunately, the glamour wore off quickly, and the couple's problems multiplied as their addictions grew.
I think we made things really hard on ourselves by doing drugs. We made complicated lives, you know, complicated to the nth degree then. I guess that's where most of my regrets about my life lie, in those years, not being fully present for my kids.
Cocaine just was never a good thing for me. It just never, there was no expression in it. To me, you might as well just... I might as well have been an ice statue.
I remember laying flat on my back in a tour bus one night and praying from the bottom of my heart, saying, don't you see how miserable I am? Can't you help me? And then kind of turning away from God too, like, well, you haven't helped me yet. I don't have any faith that you will. It was just a matter of weeks before I was in rehab, and I've never looked back.
For me and drugs, it should start and end with the fact that it really held me back. It kept me from being able to put my best foot forward for a good many years.
Although Roseanne and Rodney both overcame their addictions, the drug took an enormous toll on their already frail relationship.
When I met Rodney, he had just cleaned up. And Roseanne had just cleaned up her act also. And there was a lot of wreckage there. A lot of emotional baggage, it had gotten pretty messy.
Now drug-free, but with his marriage in disarray, Rodney Crowell focused again on his solo career. He had released 4 albums without having one major radio hit. He could not afford another commercial failure. In 1986, he signed a recording contract with Roseanne's label, CBS Columbia Records. The pressure was on Rodney as he began to record what might be his last album, Diamonds and Dirt. he called on a former band member and longtime friend, Tony Brown, to produce the album.
Tony was working for another record company, and I called him and I said, see if they'll let you come slum with me.
He said, I want you to produce my next record. And I went, you're kidding, because I hadn't, at that point, had not produced any hits.
Jimmy Bowen was Tony's boss then. And, you know, I hope Jimmy Bowen sees this, because Jimmy tried to talk Tony out of doing it, because Jimmy said, hey, man, you don't want to, don't get involved, you know, you don't want to do this with Rodney. He said, you know, he's snake bit, you know, he can't get a hit.
Jimmy Bowen said, why would you do this? I know he's your friend, but you're just setting yourself up to fail. And if you fail on a record, on another label, it really looks like you're stupid. So why would you do this? I said, I got to do it.
Diamonds and Dirt made country music history when it generated an unbroken string of 5 number one hits, a feat never accomplished before. It vindicated Rodney and Tony Brown.
It's Tony's first gold record.
And after all this time,
it was an extraordinary record, and it was an extraordinary accomplishment. And out of that came a Grammy for Song of the Year for After All This Time.
Diamonds and Dirt thrust Rodney Crowell into mainstream recording success. But Rodney's perfectionism wouldn't let him enjoy a success.
He's really a perfectionist, and Diamonds and Dirt, in his opinion, wasn't perfect.
I think subconsciously I just was not comfortable with mainstream acceptance for what I thought was inferior work.
The good news and bad news, Rodney records a smash. You know, the bad news is you've got to play these songs. This is what people are going to identify you with now.
Regardless of his ambivalence toward the album, Rodney started touring heavily to support Diamonds and Dirt. The absence from home began to wear on the fragile marriage.
All of my childhood bells were going off. He's gonna go on the road, I'll never see him, it'll be the end of our marriage, the kids will suffer, you know, because I did suffer from my dad being on the road so much, and I couldn't get past it. I couldn't stay in the present and see how it was gonna pan out with Rodney.
My relationship with Roseanne started to unravel, because I was on the road all the time. I was out performing, I had young children that were really starting to show signs of neglect.
It was as if our deepest issues and deepest fears dovetailed at that moment, at his greatest success.
Rodney and Roseanne continued to live out their lives through their songs.
If looks could kill, I would be gone today.
Coming up on CMT Inside Fame, a 12-year marriage on the rocks.
And I decided, no, I'll stay in and make it work. And when I made that decision, she said, you know, I'm out of here.
And later, Rodney comes to terms with his painful childhood.
Basically, it was, you know, I had to keep them from killing each other.
When CMT Inside Fame returns.